with the nose the same way we did with the mouth. Now, it's very simple to understand the bones of the nose. We've got the two nasal bones here and then the maxilla, which comes up right in here and fuses with the nose. These bones are run off the glabella here. And then, of course, the muscles don't really do much to influence the look of the nose. But we do have four cartilages that we're concerned with. There's a fifth cartilage that's invisible. And then a couple lightweight muscles in here. By the end of this little demonstration, we'll become familiar with those, with the anatomy of the nose. Okay, this is the depressor. And here, David, it's a triangular. That's probably what we'd call a perfect anatomy. It's as different on everybody as a fingerprint. So getting up under here and studying these depressors can really open up into seeing the way that all this, all these movements move into each other. So we want to make sure these butterflies are way out, suspended high, not close to the board. So I'm kind of putting in the profile of the nose to support these. Get them in position. I have a folded tapering hand so they don't get in the way too much. Again, we do it like a lattice work. Ouch! That piece of wire. Taking a 2x4. Getting the air out. Okay. there is the enemy. And again. Put the... Not that, that's good. I found that with these very round and geometric shapes, it's often better to square the shapes and then round them. Lantéri talks about that, doing just that thing too. Don't round the nose too soon. Okay, I'm just going to kind of merge everything together. First thing I'm going to do is work on the profile. Sides. Take their calipers. Keep them right about there. That's perfect. And a little further here. Now, I think it's important to work on the plaster model. So, to imitate the plaster model, not just the nose. So I'm going to work on the outside dimensions first. That way I can pull my measurements right off the outside dimensions. This also glues it to the board nicely. Okay. there. Got a nice taper going on. This right in here is the axial bone. It connects to the nasal bone. Anatomy of the nose merges into the anatomy of the eye and anatomy of the mouth. Now, these are called alar, and the alar means to look like a wing, appear as a wing. Half of this alar is cartilage, and half of it is a very, very minuscule muscle in the very back that pulls it back. Now, when you're working with round shape, it helps to oftentimes square your shapes. other than worrying about creating an edge around the nose, get the general direction first. And then you can worry about how everything goes up into that nostril. Now we know that there's four cartilages here. There's two cartilages here. These are the alar. They actually go off onto the nose. Right in here, it's very sensitive. The way the nose breaks, everybody's breaks just a little bit differently. Get underneath and work up inside. Going to build this bottom edge just the way it is in the plaster. That way it gives me the depth of the nose quite easily. The first shape is a big sweeping shape. Okay, so I'm getting the depth of this plaster here. That's going to give me the depth of the nostril. Now, you can say that's kind of cheating because it's not showing you how to get the measurement when you're working on the face. But it actually is not cheating because what you're doing is, as an artist, you're finding solutions continually. Okay, this is for this, this is the easiest way on this to get a good measurement that I can count on. Now we want the entire outside shape of those nostrils, those wings, these wings have a little more breadth to the back of them than the plaster sketch. This area in here too is always very interesting and is always very careful. Very characteristic in a portrait. One thing Lantéri stresses is how effective you can do your hollows. Because in doing your hollows, you can really add life to your piece. But we don't want to cut in too deep, too quickly. Now we got the shape of that depressor coming out nicely. I'm going to emphasize the two cartilages here. And the way this shadow tapers. I'm just doing a little conjecture because I know what the real plasters look like, and there's a little more. Every time you have a reproduction, you lose some detail in your plaster, so I know that there's a little more of that nasal labial line going on there. Levator muscle right there, which pulls the lip upward, has some influence right in through here too. And it's not well lit here, but that the way the wing goes into the depressor adds character. So it's good to regroup and take your clay lumps before they become hardened and remake them into sausages. We call sausages. Well, the first job I had, 13, was rolling sausages. I'm throwing them up to whoever was up on top of the scaffold at the time. Okay, now I can see where I'm deviating. This goes up a little higher. I would put this plaster over there. Now, this back on my heels. always working in profile, then you can correct the drawing. The profile gives you the contour. I could do this. Just smaller movements now. This is where it helps to stamp back a little bit. Kind of boxing in these shapes. Try not to round it too soon. So it's gross to find. Thank you. Okay, now from the square shapes that I had, now I can start kind of rounding them. Just the taper I need. It's a little flat area in there. Get all the flat spots done, taken out, then you can call it a day. And when you start getting to that stage and things start compacting, then it's just a matter of equipoise. Making sure one side is equal with the other.
Ready?
What?
Good
come in the morning with fresh eyes and probably see a few things I need to do. But for the purpose of a demonstration, I think that works, doesn't you? Straight on, better light straight on. Okay, enough?
Yeah,
the decider. Okay.